Please take your Bibles. Let's go to the Gospel of Matthew. We started this series of study last year from the Gospel of Matthew. But as you know, I took a break last 1 month to preach on the topic Bible and Science. Since I have completed that series, we will go back to Matthew again to begin where we left off. We covered the first six chapters, and now we will move on with chapter 7. So today's study comes from Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 to 5. Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 to 5. Our focus today will be mainly the first two verses, and in the light of it, we will briefly consider verses 3 to 5. We'll return, God willing, when I come back from Australia. By the way, I'll be away for 10 days to minister to Bible-Presbyterian Church of Western Australia and be back. And then we will continue again with the rest of Matthew 7. And so please now join me in the reading of God's Word. Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 to 5. We shall read it together. Ready? Let's read. Judge not, that ye be not judged. For with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Or how wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye? Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye. Here the Lord Jesus Christ teaches us to stop judging others unjustly. So often we hear people saying, don't judge others. Didn't Jesus say, judge not? It's very common. People often say it. Even Christians say that. And they often refer to Jesus as saying that we cannot judge. Because verse 1 says, judge not that ye be not judged. But is that right? Did the Lord teach us not to judge, or did the Lord teach us to judge? Now I want you to be very clear about this. Because it's very terrible when we start misquoting the Lord Jesus. That's satanic. Let me tell you, not to judge is to be a servant of the devil. Because Jesus does teach us to judge. But righteous judgment. Not unjust judgment. Righteous judgment. What Jesus is forbidding us to do in this verse when he said judge not is don't judge unrighteous judgment. Now I'm going to explain that as we go forward. But let me make it very clear. First of all, the Bible as a whole teaches to be a people who judge righteously. Now, Jesus cannot go against the Word of God. He came to fulfill the Word of God. Even every jot and tittle he fulfills. So if Jesus fulfills everything, he must teach that you must judge, but righteously. At the same time, he must also teach, as he says here, do not judge unrighteous judgment. Now, the problem that people has is that when they read the first verse, they say, well, Jesus said, judge not, full stop. They don't read the rest. Now, this is the greatest danger. You take the scripture out of context, and you read only what you want to read, and the rest you leave behind, and that's a great danger. That's how we misinterpret. We have to read everything within the context. Now, first context is, of course, scripture as a whole. The entire scripture is in perfect harmony. There is no contradiction. If you see that there's any contradiction, it's not the problem with the Bible, it's with your own thinking. Your thinking has gone wayward somewhere. That's why you think there is a lack of harmony. There's no disharmony in the scripture. And so it's very important for you to understand Jesus will not contradict the scripture because he came to fulfill the law of God and thus to prove himself to be the unblemished Son of God who can be a perfect sacrifice for us. So if the scripture says we have to judge righteously, then Jesus would stand by it. And when he says judge not, he's actually saying don't judge unrighteous judgment. So to prove beyond doubt that Jesus was teaching us to judge but not unjustly, let me show you biblical verses that prove that we have to have righteous judgment. By the way, if this really means we cannot judge, we cannot have a judicial system in the world because we have judges who keep judging people to know what is right and wrong, to settle problems, to bring a proper conduct in the nation. So Jesus wouldn't say, you cannot obey judges, especially righteous judges. The Bible says we should. Now, here are some interesting scripture portions, and I hope you will stick with me. I'm going to take you through the scriptures to show you some passages to prove this. Remember, God himself is a judge. He's a righteous judge. And under him, we are supposed to be judges, especially those whom God has appointed. And we must remember them and follow them. Now, let me quickly remind you of the situation in among the Israelites when they came out of Egypt. There was so much commotion among the people. Moses had to act as a judge. And it was a long queue of people for him to deal with. He was being worn out by the number of people who come to him to seek his judgment over the matters, to settle problems they had. And this is what we read in Exodus 18, verse 13. Exodus 18, verse 13. Moses sat to judge the people, and the people stood by Moses from the morning unto the evening. Wow. From morning unto evening, Moses had only one business. What's that? Judge people's problems. That's a very terrible situation. And you know, it happens when people don't judge themselves what is right and wrong. When people don't cling to that which is right, the poor judge has to work very hard. Can you imagine if we are all people who don't properly judge, what would happen to this country? What would happen to our church? You must be a people with proper judgment. And God always tells us to be a people with sensible thinking and proper discernment and clear judgment. Now in verse 16 of Exodus 18, we read, when they have a matter, they come unto me, Moses is speaking, and I judge between one and another, and I do make them know the statutes of God and his laws. And that's what a good judgment is all about. When people come to Moses to settle the problem, he is not trying to show off his intelligent, intellectual powers, but he is trying to teach them God's truth. So God's truth resolves the problems. They tell them what God has spoken in his word. It reminds them of the truth. So when you come for counseling, the only thing I do is to bring your attention to God's word, and that resolves the problem. Biblical counseling is what we have. We don't have so-called humanistic psychological analysis of your problems. That's nonsense. Because God's word is sufficient to meet all our problems and settle all our problems. And we should learn to resolve our problems within the counsels of God's word, which is just and true. So Moses did that. When people came to him to resolve problems, he takes the attention to God's word, he settles it for them, and God is the judge. Remember that. God is the judge when you apply God's truth and resolve problems. Deuteronomy 1:16. Moses explained why judges were appointed in Israel. He reminded the people to have a proper thinking when they come before judges. And this is the reason he explains. Deuteronomy 1:16. And I charged your judges at that time, saying, hear the causes between your brethren, and judge what? righteously. Underline that. Judges were supposed to judge righteously. And then he says, between every man and his brother and the stranger that is with him. No matter who it is, when a judge is called to make a decision, he has to be just. He cannot favor anyone. Even a judge in Israel was supposed to be just and righteous toward strangers in the land, foreigners who came by. And so God wanted just judgment among his people. Let's move on to chapter 16 of Deuteronomy, verse 18. I'm only picking some relevant ones, not all of it. In fact, the entire scripture is filled with such wonderful teachings about just judgment. But let me point you to 16th chapter of Deuteronomy, verse 18. And it says, judges and officers shall thou make thee in all thy gates. You know why? All thy gates. In ancient cities, the city gate was the center of judgment. The elders of the city will come to the gate. So when you hear people in the Old Testament that, oh, they sat at the gate, please don't think they are people who have nothing to do, waste their time playing chess at the gate. No, city gate means a place of judgment. And so it says, the judges and officers shall thou make thee in all thy gates, which the Lord thy God giveth thee throughout the tribes, and they shall judge the people with what? Just judgment. You understand? So God himself gave direction that there must be proper judicial system. There must be just services. Thinking and counseling and resolving of problems. Again, it's good to go back a little bit to Exodus 23, verses 2 and 3. Exodus 23, verses 2 and 3. And this is what we read. Listen to this. Thou shalt not follow a multitude to do evil. Now, this is very interesting, especially because of the fact that U.S. Supreme Court has voted to please the world. The Bible says when you are a judge, you never decide things based on people's opinion. Majority may want you to do evil, but don't listen to it. A just system means you do right, even though the crowd doesn't like it. And so Exodus 23 verses 2 and 3 says, thou shalt not follow a multitude to do evil. Neither shalt thou speak in a cause to decline after many to wrest judgment. Don't wrest judgment. Don't fight with judgment for the sake of democracy. Democracy is not the right best system, though people think so, because people doesn't think always in the right way. They may choose the wrong people and wrong law for the land, which may make God our enemy. Every leader should listen to God. Of course, in the Gentile world, in the unbelieving world, we can't expect that to happen. So you Christians better know, Supreme Court is not the ultimate authority. Even in Singapore, yes, in Singapore land, the government would say, listen to the court. But when the Supreme Court judges, whether it's US or Singapore or India or China, it doesn't matter. When they go against the word of God, we should not obey them. We rather obey God than people. You understand? That's what the Bible says. Don't be afraid. The whole world is going to tell us all kinds of things against God's word. When we say, well, homosexuality is a sin, the world will say you are an extremist. You are unkind. No, we are not being unkind. We are telling the truth that homosexuality or fornication or adultery or any kind of sexual immorality is going to take you to hell. God will judge you, the scripture says. We cannot shut our mouth because people are against it. And let me tell you, parents, you better tell the children the truth as it is in the scripture. Don't shut your mouth because that's not the popular voice of the society. Because if you don't tell the truth, that God wants us to tell the truth, well, you will lose your children to the world. And so God reminded the Israelites, don't follow a multitude to do evil. Judge righteously. Leviticus 19:15 says this. Listen. Leviticus 19:15 says, ye shall do no unrighteousness in judgment. It's a very clear statement. Don't ever judge unrighteously. Thou shalt not respect the person of the poor, nor honor the person of the mighty, but in righteousness shalt thou judge thy neighbor. Now that's interesting. You have to judge your neighbor also. So you have to judge who is sitting next to you, all right? Don't be silly. If the person starts talking to you when I'm preaching, you tell them, shut up, please. You better judge him that he is talking nonsense and he's not supposed to talk, right? If he shows you your handphone, he see a message came, can you take a look? You tell him, throw it away. This is God's house. You better judge your neighbor whether he's telling the truth or doing the right. You cannot just follow your neighbor everywhere. But when you judge him, judge righteously. Don't falsely accuse a person. Go to 2 Chronicles chapter 19, if you can. Turn quickly. 2 Chronicles 19. And I'm going to read a few verses from there, verses 6 to 10. Second Chronicles 19, verse 6. And by the way, this is a record of events that happened during the King Jehoshaphat. And King Jehoshaphat was a good king among a line of many wicked kings. And he said to the judges of the land in Israel, take heed what ye do, for ye judge not for man, but for the Lord. Did you hear that? You judge for not for man, but for the Lord. So if you have a friend and an enemy come before your judgment seat, let's say you are the judge, you feel like favoring your friend. You cannot. There's only one man matters in judgment. That's God. You judge not for man, but for the Lord who is with you in the judgment. You better understand this. It's a very serious matter for Christians. Maybe non-Christians don't bother about what is written in the scriptures, but we got to take care. If you go into practice of law, if you're going to be a lawyer, an advocate, and you better know this, if in your particular area of service as a lawyer, if you cannot speak for Christ, if the world that hired you want you to speak for the people, you better resign and go and do something else. Because let's not defy the truth and judgment of God. It may be a powerful position as an attorney. It may be a powerful position as a prosecutor. But if that would not let you, please God, don't take it up. Otherwise your mouth will be always saying things that doesn't please God. Any position in life, we must remember, we have only one business on earth. And that is to speak for the Lord, not speak for man. When you speak for the Lord, it will benefit man. When you speak for man without for God's glory, it's going to destroy him in the long run. It's very clear, isn't it? And read on in that text. Jehoshaphat told the judges in the land, take heed what ye do, for ye judge not for man, but for the Lord who is with you in the judgment. Therefore now let the fear of the Lord be upon you. Take heed and do it, for there is no iniquity with the Lord our God, nor respect of persons, nor taking of gifts, means no bribery. God will not allow any of these things. So if you want a clean, pure, sound, just system, you better stay with the Lord. Do what he says. Otherwise, you will be influenced by man. Moreover, in Jerusalem did Jehoshaphat set for the Levites and of the priests and of the chief of the fathers of Israel for the judgment of the Lord and for controversies when they returned to Jerusalem. So Jehoshaphat said, when people come to Jerusalem for justice, when they come to the officers and judges, let them remember it is the judgment of the Lord that they should render, not their feelings, their opinion, their twisted judgment because of their favor for people. It has to be God's judgment that they let the people know. And so it continues by saying, he charged them, saying, thus shall ye do in the fear of the Lord, faithfully and with a perfect heart, and what cause soever shall come to you of your brethren that dwell in the cities, between blood and blood, between law and commandment, statutes and judgments, ye shall even warn them that they trespass not against the Lord. And so wrath came upon you and upon your brethren. This do, and ye shall not trespass. Every judgment, when violence occurs, blood against blood, when miscarriage of justice occurs, again, law against commandment, let the judge know his ultimate duty is to please God and not man. But this is not what's happening today. Well, one might say, well, this could be possible in the ancient Israel because God was the king, in a sense, and this was God's people, God's nation. I agree. But when we live in a heathen world, a secular nation, how can you expect this to happen? Yes, I know it won't happen. But we Christians got to have the right thinking. We are in God's kingdom. Our church must function not like the world, but like God's kingdom. Christ is our head. He is a righteous king. And we cannot appear before God and say, oh Lord, everybody in my nation lived like this, so I follow the crowd. Sorry, then go where the crowd goes, to hell. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. You remember that. You can't give excuse that, oh Lord, you better understand. We live in a world where nobody understands these things. No point talking about it. It's impossible to live. Then you die and be with me. For to me to live is Christ, and then die is gain. If you cannot live for Christ, then be prepared to die. Persecution and death is real for Christians. It is not Christian's duty to save his life to please the world, but to give his life to please God. That's our calling. You better get this right. Otherwise, you will be a bunch of compromisers and hypocrites in God's kingdom. And we cannot afford to be that. That's not why God called. If we have to do anything at all for Christ's sake, you must have a commitment to God's justice, not man's pleasure. Judge not as you like. That's what Jesus meant. Judge as God wants. You see, he had to teach them. Remember, the crowd is a Jewish crowd. They have gone awry. They have gone wrong. They have been living as they like. And whatever they do, just sanctify it with their own rituals and all that and say, this is how God wants us to be. It was a horrible system. You remember, this is a system that denied Jesus any justice. They killed Jesus. Just imagine, was there ever a righteous man like Christ? Was there ever a pure heart like that of Christ? And yet they condemn him. They twisted the justice system. And to that crowd, Jesus says, judge not, because you don't know how to judge. If you judge the way you judge, I will judge you. That's what he said. Judge not that ye be not judged. Who will judge you? God. So please, when you judge, remember, you are not the ultimate judge. Even you will be judged. Even if you are the Supreme Court judge, if you judge against God's will, you will be judged by God, who is just. There is no escape. Do you get what Jesus is saying? He's not telling us not to judge, but he's saying judge the way God wants us to judge. Stop judging the way you judge, but stand with the Lord. Go to Psalms. In the book of Psalms, we also see this being completely exalted for the glory of God and for the edification of the people. This great truth is preached. Psalm 58, verses 1 and 2, the first two verses. David here cries out, and this is a rhetorical question. Answer is obvious. And he asks, do ye indeed speak righteousness, O congregation? Do ye judge uprightly, O ye sons of men? What a question. God's people have gathered together to worship of God, and David says to them, do ye indeed speak righteousness, O congregation, do you judge uprightly, ye sons of men? Why was there such a question? Why would the Lord ask the people who came to worship, do you judge righteously? Not because everyone is a judge, cannot be, right? In a congregation, not everyone is a judge. But everyone was addressed. Not one person was left out in this question. Why? Because everyone has the duty to make decisions in life as God wants it to be. We got to sieve out everything that is unjust in the sight of God. So God asks, you come back to me, right? You have come back after living 1 week. Now you're all here to praise me. But I have a question. Have you judged righteously throughout the past week? Have you been living for me? Have you been speaking the way I want you to speak? If not, you are not my worshiper. You understand? You don't come to me with your nice songs and prayers and offerings. I don't need that. What I need is you represent me in the world. That's worship. If you live and talk in a way that will not praise me as a righteous God, you are not my worshiper. You get out of my presence. And so these questions were asked. Soul-searching questions. You look at verse 2, you will see it. Why such a question was asked? Because, O ye sons of men, yea, in heart ye work wickedness, and ye wear the violence of your hands in the earth. In the heart you work out wickedness, and you have no problem violently living, hurting others. It's no problem for me because you are thinking for yourself and not what God wants. And God doesn't like such a congregation. You know, I don't think God is pleased that so many of you came. But he'll be very pleased if your heart is clean and committed to the righteousness of Christ. He's not pleased with your dress. That's not going to make him say, oh, I'm so glad. Did you notice there were some rich guys in our congregation today? One was wearing Rolex watch and the other one was having a golden frame spectacle. And he drove a BMW and one Mercedes. How happy I am. The elite ones of Singapore are in my congregation. God forbid. He's searching our hearts. Or will God say, do you notice who came for worship? The commander-in-chief, the chief justice, the Supreme Court judge, the MP, the great man. You think God is so pleased? Who are you, man? Have you done my justice? You are nothing. I am nothing. My intellectual power is nothing. For God, who created the world and put all things in motion, he put the principles for life and the sustenance of this universe. And we better exalt him by humble and ready heart to obey him. Otherwise, there's no worship. Judge not, lest ye be judged. Don't ever be smart in trying to pick other people's mistake when you don't see your own mistakes. When you are not aligning with God, who are you to talk about others? Because you are under condemnation already. Do you get it? That's what Jesus is saying. Go to Psalm 82, please. Psalm 82, verse 2. What do you get? Here the psalmist says, how long will he judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked? People are trying to please those who live unrighteously because they want the favor of wicked men who are in power and great prosperity. So the Lord says, how long will you do it? You know, it's so sad when you look at pastors and leaders of the church who are so busy trying to please the rich men in the crowd and the poor are forgotten. Righteousness is never served. And many churches now run to please a worldly, materialistic crowd. And they are not mindful what God requires. How long will you do this? How long will you judge unrighteously? Psalm 94. verses 20 to 21. You got to get this right in your head. Because everything Jesus said was in fulfillment of what is already revealed. He is not saying anything against the scripture. He affirms the scripture when he said in Matthew 7, judge. So let's read the rest. Psalm 94. Let's read together. Join me. Just to make sure you're not falling asleep. Let's read loud. Psalm 94, verses 20 and 21. Ready, go. Shall the throne of iniquity have fellowship with thee, which frameth mischief by a law? They gather themselves together against the soul of the righteous and condemn the innocent blood. Shall the throne of iniquity, what a shame. No throne should be characterized by sin. However, God says there are thrones of iniquity in this world. And then God asked this question, shall the throne of iniquity have fellowship with thee, which frameth mischief by law? You know, they pass laws and amendments to constitution to make wickedness legal. Isn't it what's happening today? Once gambling was a sin, even in this country, but now legalized gambling is okay. Prostitution is a sin, but there is legalized prostitution. Correct? I just was listening to BBC on Saturday. I was shocked. They were interviewing girls who study in famous universities in the UK, such as Cambridge and Oxford and others. And these girls are now looking for, according to this report, sugar daddies. You know what is that? They give sexual services to rich men so they can live a glamorous life. These are intelligent girls. In the late teens and early 20s. Boy. And then this interviewer asked one of the two girls whom they were interviewing, is it not prostitution? Then he said, yes, you might say it, but we are not doing because we are poor. We just want to enjoy life and make some money. We don't want to end our university studies with a loan. We want to pay while we are studying, and this is the best way to do it. And I was shocked because BBC did this documentary because it's a widespread problem in the world. And in America, it is a very prominent business among university kids. That's why they are flamboyant. They are so flashy. They got so much money. Where do you think they get all this? Through wickedness. Now the world has been legalizing homosexuality because the CEOs of multinational companies are greatly indulged in homosexuality. If you don't allow them, they won't come into your country and they will not lead businesses. So in order to have these mighty men of power and wealth, we legalize everything. Do you understand? You better know this. They fill the earth with wickedness. So God asked this question. Will you have fellowship with thrones of iniquity? I thank God for a sister who is in our midst who was having a fantastic job with big salary and all that. I don't know how big, but I think it's big. And she was very well accepted and received by the company. But she was asked to organize special meetings for lesbians in the multinational company. She said she will not do it. She resigned. And this happened in our congregation. I thank God for her courage. Gave up everything. But let me tell you, you probably have to give up your studies. You probably have to give up your work just to be righteous. Don't you go and have fellowship with the world and come back and say, judge not. You're already judged by your deed. I don't have to say anything. Your own action has judged you. But you don't want to recognize it. So the Lord asked this question. Will you have fellowship with thrones of iniquity? Will you allow them to control your life? Go to Proverbs, please. Proverbs 17:15. Proverbs 17:15. He that justifieth the wicked, and he that condemneth the just, even they both are abomination to the Lord. He that justifieth the wicked. That's what just happened in the U.S. I was looking at the celebration of people in New York. It was on CNN. And they were showing all the placard. They say, we celebrate the fact that the Bible-based morality is condemned. You see that? This is one of the placard that says, we are glad that Bible-based morality is condemned. Yes, I agree. That's what this world is. Bible is derided. The creation account, I spoke about it last 1 month, is derided. They say evolution is correct. So our great-grandfather was a monkey. They want us to believe that. They throw that out. Day and night in science courses, our children are told, don't believe in Bible account. So Genesis 1 is a myth. Just a story. Don't believe it. Then why should you believe the rest of the Bible? Now morality is out. What will be here on earth? Let's pray. Lord, come quickly. Come quickly, Lord. I just cannot believe, just cannot take my mind to think what it will be like my grandchildren if they are alive, if I will have grandchildren. I don't know. My kids are not yet married. I don't know whether they get married. I don't know whether they will have children. I don't know whether Christ will come before. But let's say, what if I have a third generation? What will it be like? Just don't want to think. But just cry, Lord, have mercy. Give them wisdom to know you. I don't ask for my children to be the best in the world and they fill the academia of this world. No, that's not my prayer. I pray they will be partakers of God's righteousness. And I know it can mean nothing in this world. It's fine. We'll be thrown out of our jobs. We'll be thrown out of our schools. We'll be thrown out of everything in this world. And the Antichrist is coming. Those who love Christ, there's no place. If you don't have his mark, you can't even buy and sell. Do you know this? So why do you love the world so much? Why do you want to make sure that your children are going to enjoy the world? Please stop thinking this way. Set your affections on things above and start praying that their souls will not be lost. Even he that justified the wicked and he that condemneth the just, both are abomination to the Lord. Proverbs 31 verse 9. Well, you know, that's the last chapter in the book of Proverbs, and it's a guidance given by a mother to his son. And the son was King Lemuel, and his mother taught the young prince how to be a king. And she was a godly woman, and she said this to her son. Proverbs 31, verse 9. Open thy mouth, judge righteously, and plead the cause of the poor and needy. When you are in the positions of power, please judge righteously. Don't use your powerful position to turn righteousness away from the land. This actually happened in Israel. So go to Isaiah, see how God responded to it. Isaiah chapter 5, verses 20 to 23. Let's go quick. Please stay with me. Isaiah 5, 22 to 23. Read with me. Woe unto them. Okay, I will wait for you. You're still turning, I can hear. It's nice to hear you turning the Bible. It gives me a special joy that you bring the Bible and turn to it. Okay, let's go. Ready? Isaiah 5, 22 to 23. Woe unto them that are mighty to drink wine, and men of strength to mingle strong drink, which justify the wicked for reward, and take away the righteousness of the righteous from him. God, through prophet Isaiah, declared woe. Terrible damnation. God said, I condemn your ways. You like to get drunk, you like to seek mixed wine, and when you are intoxicated, you don't get justice going because you can't think well. Okay, our world is an intoxicated world today. Party drugs, huh? Even in Singapore, though there is death penalty for bringing in drugs, it's not decreasing. It's ever increasing, right? And people in high positions use party drugs. CNB is trying very hard to control it, but they are not winning the battle. And that's why our church has a drug ministry to the drug addicts. It's not getting better. Wine drinking is a terrible thing. Why there is miscarriage of justice? You are intoxicated with many things, whether it's wine or beer or rum or whatever you drink, it doesn't matter. Whether it's drugs you pop into your mouth or you inject through your vein, it doesn't matter. Whatever distort your thinking should not ever be entertained. Because justice will not be carried out. You know, one of the reasons why I respected Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, the founding prime minister, who is gone no more, though he's not a Christian, he had some sound principles. If the minister is a drunk, get out. Right? You got an Indian president of yours out because he was drinking and womanizing. I think very good. By the way, he was a Malayali, just like me. So I was not bitter that Singapore government got him out. When I read about it, I thought, very good. We don't want drunks up in the leadership of the country. You will go down. But unfortunately, we have in board of elders in many churches who are drunks. And our people on the stage playing guitar and dancing, they are also under the spell of, not the Holy Spirit, something else. You look at them. They need a kick to play and dance like this, to entertain the crowd in the church. One man who played guitar in Joseph Prince Church called The Rock, most popular one in Singapore. He was in our care ministry for the drug addicts. And this man told me, he went to play guitar on Sunday morning in the church after taking drugs. And he was living with a woman who is not his wife. And there was no question asked. As long as you can play guitar, please come. God be praised. What rubbish. This is modern church. Thousands will gather because of music. I'm not against music, you know that. I love music. But not at the expense of righteousness. Don't we have to judge? Oh yes, every day. But not without God. Not according to our own thinking, according to the just God. If not, God will say to you, woe unto you. Judge not, lest he be judged. So don't judge wrong judgment that will bring you to judgment of God, but judge so you will not enter into God's judgment. How clear. Now how about judging within the church? Shall we judge? Do we have to judge? Oh yes, Jesus anticipated this. Now listen to this. This is taken from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 18. We will come to this text and study in detail later on, God willing. But let me just read this passage. You are very familiar with it, I'm sure. Matthew 18, verses 15 to 17. What did Jesus say here? Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, Go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. So you've got to judge whether your brother has done something wrong or not. So if you have judged that your brother has done something wrong, what should you do? Never mind. Sweep it under the carpet? No. You go to him and confront him. Brother, this is wrong. Right? Then Jesus went on to say, in verse 16, in the middle of verse 15, if he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. Now verse 17, and if he shall neglect to hear them, tell it unto the church. If he neglect to hear the church, let him be unto thee as an heathen man and a publican. Wow. Started as a brother, end up as a heathen and publican. How come your mind changed? Because you judge him to be unrepentant sinner. Do you understand? The church got this business. Church is not just to get people in. Sometimes church's duty is to get people out. Do you understand? I've said that many times. Preaching is not just to entertain people. Preaching is also to get the unbelieving, unrepentant out of the church. Sinners have no part in God's people's congregation. We are all sinners, but we come with repentance because we know God judges. So we humbly accept our sins and yield ourselves to live according to God's holy law. But if you sit there that you are right when you're wrong in the sight of God, you are an idol in this church. You shouldn't be here. You better get out. If you have no business to repent, please don't come here, because you are going to be offended day and night, and we are going to treat you as a heathen, and we will do it. We don't care whether you were baptized by me or somebody else, or whether you are in the membership role. You better go. Otherwise, we will treat you as heathen. We will try everything possible to win you. We will come to you personally. We will come with two or three witnesses. We will come as a church. If you don't listen, goodbye. That's what the Lord said. Not what I say, but the Lord said, right? The Lord said, treat him no more as a brother, but as a heathen. You better obey Jesus. There must be judgment within the church. You know, in the Corinthian church, there was a problem. Whenever there was an issue between two members of the church, they will run to the court and they sue one another for personal matters. And Paul heard about it. His heart was so sad. And this is what he said. You better read this. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 4 onwards. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. In fact, in the earlier part of that chapter, he says, in the future, we will even judge or rule over angels. And then he said, if that's the case, now look at verse 4. If then ye have the judgments, things pertaining to this life, set them to judge who are least esteemed in the church. He says, when you have a problem and you have to have a judgment to be carried out, why do you go to people whom we do not esteem highly? That means people who are not believers, people who are not followers of Christ. Why do you go to unbelieving people? And then he asks in verse 5, I speak to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you? So we are to be wise in the church. All of you has to be wise. Sometimes when there's a problem between two brothers, you must, if you know it, you must go to both of them and say, come, let's resolve this. If you find it difficult, then you bring them to someone who can resolve the problem in the church. Maybe to a church elder or to a church preacher or a pastor, whoever available. You bring them. It's your duty. You cannot run away from it. We are going to be wise because we don't want our people to end up in the courtroom. But of course, I know some things are official, which government has a say. And at that time, you have to go to the government. For instance, if a man if the treasurer of this church take money away, but you will not acknowledge it, well, government requires an auditor. When the auditor find it out, well, it become a court case. You cannot help it. But individual matters between two, we must judge. That's what the Bible says. Not an unbelieving person. So very clearly, verse 5, I speak to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you? No, not one that shall be able to judge between his brethren. But brother goeth to law with brother, and that before the unbelievers. Now therefore, there is utterly a fault among you, because you go to law one with another. Why do ye not rather take wrong? Why do ye not rather suffer yourselves to be defrauded? Why will you not allow others to defraud you? In other words, why not you suffer some loss for the sake of your brother? And don't go to the court and get him corrected. You know, let's say I loan somebody in this church. Well, anyway, I'm not a rich man. Don't come to me. I have no money to loan you. But let's say, for illustration purpose, I loan somebody in this church $10,000. And he said, Pastor, I will return after 1 month. I said, for sure, I trust you. After 1 month, he didn't return. He did not even come to me to explain that he can't return now. Please give me 2 weeks or 3 weeks. Nothing. He just kept quiet. So I kept quiet. 3 weeks over, 4 weeks over, 4 months over, and 1 year gone, still says nothing. So I felt very troubled. So I go to the brother and say, Brother, you said after 1 month you will return. I didn't hear anything from you. Will you return? Aya, you are a Christian. Christians are supposed to be patient. You have to forbear one another. Be loving. I'm just testing your love. Well, I don't think so. You are being a thief. The wicked borroweth and not return. That's what the Bible says. Why don't you try to pay me? Maybe not all the $10,000. Try $100 a month. I try, and after paying $500 over 5 months, he says, I already paid you $5,000. Huh? You can't take it. You go to the church elder, and the church elder says, okay, do you have any evidence? Oh, no evidence. Only both of us. I didn't ask him to sign a paper. So how to help you? Oh. Never mind, let me talk to that brother. Is it true you borrowed $10,000? Yes, yes, yes. Okay, so no need contract, you agreed. Okay, let me try and solve your problem with the brother. How much did you return? $5,000. Hey, but he says $500. He doesn't know mathematics, that's the problem. He doesn't know how to count the zeros. Maybe he tried to wriggle away. No, no evidence of anything. No papers signed, no contract, no receipt, nothing. What should we do? There are many options to pursue. Let's suffer and leave the matter to God. I'm not teaching you how to take advantage of nice and innocent people. If you do that, the Lord will catch you and throw you out. And that's for sure. But I'm warning you. In the church, unfortunately, we will have this kind of situation. We already have many, and many will come. So be very careful. When you enter into business with another Christian, be willing to suffer loss. Don't go into a partnership to fight him in the court. It can happen sometimes, but it's very important how we manage this. Now, another situation in which the church has to exercise judgment is when you listen to the preaching. You cannot just sit there and accept everything I say. You need to listen to God's word being preached with a judging spirit. Do you know, in the book of Acts, the believers in Berea were praised for their attitude in listening to God's word? This is what we read. Acts 17, verse 11. Even in listening to God's word, you must exercise proper judgment. How do you know whether the preacher is correct or not? Well, this is what you should do. Verse 11 of Acts 17. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind and what? Search the scriptures daily whether those things were so. They compare the preaching with God's word. You know, if you are going to church and don't bother to read the scriptures very much, you just take everything that the pastor says of the pulpit, you can be in the wrong church under a wrong pastor, because you never bother to examine things whether they are so. What does that mean? The congregation must be as educated as a pastor. Do you get it? Otherwise, how do you know whether what the pastor says is right? There are some people in the church that are thinking, oh, whatever the pastor says is right. So he says, take your wallet, open it, see the biggest bill, take it out, and put in an envelope, write Pastor Koshy. And he will say, amen, God will bless me. And he will say, he that soweth sparingly will reap sparingly. He that soweth abundantly will reap abundantly. So if you give a big bill, you get big bill, all right? So praise the Lord, amen, hallelujah. Can you feel it? Lift up your hands. It's in the air. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Hallelujah. And these guys will buy a jet and cruise across the world and live in luxurious palace-like house and say, God bless me. These are cheats. And they fill Christendom today. Why? People are undiscerning. They don't judge. Because they say, Jesus said, don't judge. Jesus said, don't judge stupidly. Don't judge unrighteously. Don't judge against God's word, but judge the way God judged. They don't listen. I hope you come to this church because you judge my preaching and my life and found it scriptural, not because you are my friend. There must be judgment in the church. But that doesn't mean you want to show that you are a judging Christian. So today you go out and call a group and say, you know, I got something to tell you. Don't act like a rebel. God will judge you. Only if you are absolutely sure after the study of God's word that you are right, then you can speak that. Otherwise, go and learn. If you have questions, come and ask the pastor. Don't let the preacher go home easily, okay? Give him some work to do. A lot of pastors have nothing to do. Sunday morning preach, then go and sleep. And watch TV. Then come next Sunday and say something. And they say, we are 24 hours working. No, it's a lie. A lot of them are sleeping. So send emails. Send SMS. What? Pastor, are you playing golf or studying Bible? Please, get yourself educated. Don't be silly, congregation. Learn God's word. Be thorough in your understanding, that the man of God may be thoroughly furnished unto all good works, that our church will not be infiltrated with wicked men and deceive us. Judge, righteous judgment. Time is up, isn't it? Almost. All right, let me just read a couple more verses and then we conclude. And we come back and study. It's really a wonderful study. I hope you will be well edified with these things that we study from God's word. Now, Romans 16:19. I'm going to read quickly. You just jot down. I'm not going to wait. Let's go. Romans 16:19. For you, obedience is come abroad unto all men. I am glad, therefore, on your behalf, but yet I would have you wise unto that which is good and simple concerning evil. Paul says to the Roman church, I want you to be wise. How? Be wise unto good and simple toward evil. In other words, you've got to make differentiation between what is good and what is bad. And you must be wise to adhere to good, and simple means careless toward evil. Don't be bothered by evil things. Are you a person who seek after good things? You know, we are taught in the scriptures that we must abound in good works, right? Not unto salvation, but those who are saved by faith must give themselves to do good works, which God has commanded. Isn't that right? Obedience is a proof of our salvation. So every Christian must always think, what is the good thing God wants me to do? You got to find it out. Be wise unto it. There are some Christians in the church say, what to do? I don't know what to do. I went to church, nothing to do. I come home. But every day our life is supposed to be wise unto good works. Be wise. Open your eyes and see what God wants you to do. You got to judge yourself when you are not doing good. Something is wrong with me. I better get right. So in the church, you not only judge between people who have problems, you also judge the pastor who preach, whether he's right or not. You also judge yourself to see whether you are adhering to the good that God wants. Prove all things. 1 Thessalonians 5:21. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. Romans 12:2. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Every day our mind must be renewed to think what is right, according to the perfect will of God. A renewed mind is a mind that judges for God's glory. And we have to have a renewed mind, not a mind that is stuck in the sins and worldliness of this world, but liberated for God's glory. Well, there are so many more verses like this in the scripture that tells us to judge and adhere to good things. In 1 John chapter 4, we are told, try every spirit. Because believe not every spirit, but try every spirit, whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. When Jesus commended the church in Ephesus, in the seven letters he wrote in the book of Revelation, this is what Jesus said about the church in Ephesus, Revelation 2:2. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. And then Jesus said this about the church in Ephesus. Thou hast tried them, means tested them, examined them and proved. Thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. Jesus commended the church in Ephesus because they were given to examine those people who came around as prophets and apostles and found them not truly apostles. And Jesus commended them for that. I hope we will be such a church. We will not entertain every buddy who say I'm a pastor and preacher and come by. We examine them first and be careful. Otherwise the Lord will condemn us. We want to be commended at his coming. And let's be a church that judge not unrighteously but justly. We'll come back, God willing, next time when I'm back on the pulpit to study the rest and be filled with God's word. Let's all arise and sing our final hymn.